Charlton Heston. I'm not a priest or a scholar. I'm an actor. I tell stories. I want to take you with me on an odyssey. Along the way, I'll tell you some of the oldest and greatest stories on Earth, the stories from the Bible. Blurred by the centuries, no one can really mark the birth of the early stories in the Bible or put them firmly in any time or place.
We can't even be sure when the Bible passed beyond the fragile grasp of simple oral tradition and began at last to be written down. We do know that in 1947, the oldest surviving written text of the biblical stories was found here, near the shores of the Dead Sea in the hills above this ancient Essene monastery in Wadi Qumran. I think it's appropriate that the discovery was made by a shepherd looking for a lost lamb. History does not record whether the shepherd, a Bedouin named Mohammed Deeb, ever found his lost lamb, but he did stumble on the most important biblical discovery of modern times. Searching in a cave in this ravine, he came across some nondescript clay jars. Inside them were several battered leather bundles wrapped in decaying linen. They seemed worthless. The shepherd almost destroyed them until he remembered that foreign scholars sometimes bought the unlikeliest sort of trash. He sold them for a few drachmas. Inside the bundles were dozens of parchment scrolls. For some time, they drifted through the Byzantine black market in which such artifacts are traded in the Middle East. Eventually, archaeologists identified the scrolls as biblical texts, written in Hebrew and predating any other such documents by at least 1,000 years. The Dead Sea Scrolls contain almost every story in the Old Testament.
When God expelled Adam and Eve from the idyllic innocence of Eden after the fall, their descendants undertook a generational journey through this desert land. Over the centuries, the sand was long erased, the marks of their migrations. But from Cain's exile, eastward in Eden, from the father's seed through the countless generations, Noah and Shem, Abraham and Isaac, Jacob and Joseph, Genesis traces the evolution of the people God is moving to a new land. In each story, God lays his hand on a single man, flawed, uncertain, but guided by God. Each new patriarch moves to fulfill his inscrutable purpose. Who can measure the spirit of the Lord? What man knows his plan? So at last we come to Egypt, the greatest of all the epic dramas in the Hebrew Bible, the story of Moses, echoing also through the Christian Old Testament and the Muslim Quran, will inexorably play out. What it must have been like many millennia ago at the height of pharaonic civilization is hard to imagine. These awesome, weathered monuments, still among the wonders of the world, are only the bones of ancient Egypt. Now there would come a new king in Egypt. Some believe this was Ramses II, grandson of Seti. The pyramids were already over 1,000 years old when Ramses was born. But Ramses would leave his own monuments all over Egypt, a legacy to commemorate his greatness, his many victories, and celebrate his own divinity. Long before Moses was to lead the children of Israel out of bondage, free at last, a young man, Joseph, the great-grandson of Abraham and grandson of Isaac, brought them to a safe haven in Egypt, where they would prosper under the protective reign of a benevolent pharaoh. When a new and hostile pharaoh arises to threaten them, God chooses an infant. He cast into Egypt the seed of a man. The man was Moses. The children of Israel were fruitful. The land was filled with them. But at last there arose a new king over Egypt. And he said, "The children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come, let us deal wisely, lest they multiply and join against us." Therefore, he set taskmasters over them. They made the children of Israel serve bitterly in hard bondage in the fields, making brick. But still they multiplied. So Pharaoh charged all his people, saying, "These Hebrews shall find no ease.
Never shall the soles of their feet have rest. In the morning they shall say, would God it were night. And at night they shall say, would God it were morning. The sword without and terror within shall destroy them, and the heart of Israel shall be cast down. Now therefore, destroy every male among their little ones. Every son that is born, he shall cast into the river, that I may lift up my hand to heaven and say, I live forever. But now, the Spirit of God moved in the land. Jochebed, wife of Amram, conceived and bore a son. He was a goodly child. When she saw him, she said, he shall live. And she hid him 3 months. And when she could no longer hide him, she made for him a basket of bulrushes and daubed it with pitch and put the child there inside. And she laid it in the reeds at the river's edge. And his sister hid nearby to see what would be done to him. Now the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe in the river with her maidens. She walked by the water, and when she saw the basket among the reeds, she sent her maid to fetch it. When she'd opened it, she saw the child. And behold, the babe wept, and she took pity on him. She said, this is one of the Hebrews' children. I will take this child. He shall be my son and a prince over all men. And because I drew him out of the water, his name shall be called Moses. And so, at last, it came to pass that when Moses was grown, he went out of the city to his brethren. And when he saw an Egyptian striking one of the Hebrews, Moses' anger waxed hot. He lifted his hand and slew the Egyptian. Then Moses said, surely when this thing is known, Pharaoh will slay me. So he fled from the wrath of Egypt and came at last to the land of Midian and dwelt there and kept the flocks of Jethro. And Jethro gave Moses his daughter, Zipporah, and she bore him a son. And Moses was content. He said, I have been a stranger in a strange land. But in Egypt, the children of Israel cried in their bondage, and their cry came up to God. And God heard them and remembered. Now in the desert of Midian, where Moses kept his flocks, he came to the mountain of God called Sinai. And he looked and beheld a bush that burned with fire. But the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight. And when he'd climbed to the place, God called to him out of the midst of the fire, Moses, Moses. And he said, I am here. And the voice said, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. I am the God of thy fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and heard their cries, for I know their sorrows. Therefore I will send thee, Moses, and thou shalt bring forth my people to serve me upon this mountain. And Moses said, who am I, Lord, that I should go to bring Israel out of bondage? Behold, when I come to the people and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me, they will not believe me. They shall say, what is his name? And how shall I answer them? And God said to Moses, I am that I am. Thou shalt say, I am hath sent me to you. This is my name forever, and they will believe thee. Now therefore go, and I will be with thee.
Sinai, the cruel desert of rocks and ragged mountains. In ancient times, this wasteland was a crossroads where Bedouin shepherds wandered, a safe refuge for a man fleeing from the wrath of Pharaoh. For Moses, this was his testing time in the wilderness. In this cauldron of heat and isolation, the man Moses comes face to face with God, the first step on a journey that would change the world.
Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Surely holy ground to Jews and Christians, but also to Muslims. Because of their reverence for Moses, they call it Jabal Musa, the mountain of Moses. That's how far the shadow of the man Moses reaches. He was a man, remember. None of the three religions that reveres him calls him divine. He was a man. And flawed, as all of us. But he was also surely a great man, lawgiver and deliverer to the Jews, warrior prophet to Muslims, first among the prophets to Christians, the man of whom Jesus said, "If ye believe Moses, so shall ye believe me." Driven into exile and content in marriage to a shepherd's daughter, Moses is drawn up the slopes of Mount Sinai to see the bush that burns but is not consumed. Here in this empty, stony land, from a burning cauldron of power, energy, and light, Moses hears the voice of God commanding him to deliver his people. "Who am I, Lord," says Moses, "that I should bring Israel out of bondage?" A good question for a simple shepherd. Exodus describes him as slow of speech, but he goes, armed only with his unwavering faith. The God of Israel would deliver his people. But first, Moses must act. So Moses went, returned into Egypt with his wife and his sons and the staff of God in his hand. And with his brother Aaron, he went into Pharaoh and said, "Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, let my people go." And Pharaoh said, "Who is this God that I should obey his voice? I know not thy God. Neither will I let Israel go. You would keep these people from their labor with your vain words. They are idle, idle, and you would make them rest. Therefore there shall be more work for them. Go tell them, thus saith Pharaoh, I shall give you straw to make brick as poor. Let them get straw for themselves. But the tally of must not lend. And work." Moses and Aaron came forth Pharaoh. The people turned from them, saying, "Wherefore did thou? You put a sword in their hands to us." And Moses said in it, "Lord, why hast thou sent me thy name?" And the Lord said to Moses, "I will make thee as a god, Pharaoh. Go again to him. Take thy staff and stretch forth thy hand upon the river. You shall thy wonders in the land. And in this shall they know that I am the Lord." And Moses did as the Lord commanded. He lifted up his staff in the sight of Pharaoh and struck the waters. The river turned to blood. Throughout all the land of Egypt, the waters turned to blood. And the fish died in the river stank. Egyptians not drink. But the Pharaoh was hardened. So Moses said to him, that thou mayest know there is none like unto the Lord. And he smote the dust of the earth with his staff, and the dust became lice. Pharaoh's magicians could do nothing. There were lice upon man and beast, and the frogs came up out of the river and covered the land, and they hide in the houses. Then there came swarms of flies. The land stank, and the cattle died. The people were stricken with sores, save only the children of Israel. And the ministers of Pharaoh said, "This is the finger of God." But Pharaoh would not listen. He drove Moses and Aaron from his presence. Then did Moses stretch forth his hand to heaven. And the Lord rained hail upon the earth. Fire ran along the ground. And there was a thick darkness over all the land for 3 days. The earth was good and the green thing broken. And Pharaoh's ministers cried to him, "How long shall this man on us? Let them go, that they may serve their God. Knowest thou not yet? Egypt is destroyed." And Pharaoh called for Moses and said, "Take away from me death." Moses spread his hands. The thunder ceased. He said, "How long will thou refuse to humble thyself? Saith the Lord of Israel, let my people go." And Pharaoh said, "Get thee from." So Moses said, "Will the Lord bring one more plague upon it? About night will the Lord smite the firstborn from Pharaoh on his throne to the captives in his dungeons. And against children of Israel shall not a dog move his tongue." And Pharaoh said in great anger, "Take you see my face no more. For on the day you see my face again, you shall sure die." And Moses said, "Thou hast spoken well. We'll see the face no more." And he turned and went out in the city. Then Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, "This day shall be the beginning to you, for the Lord hath spoken. Make ready to eat in haste this night of unleavened bread and lamb. Let each man take of the blood of the lamb and mark the door of his house. None shall go out till the morning, for tonight would smite the Egyptians. When he sees the mark upon your door, he will not for the desire to come, but will pass over your house. And this day shall you remember forever." And the people bowed their heads and did as the Lord commanded. And at night, it came to pass, as Moses said, all the firstborn of Egypt were struck. There was a house where there was not one dead. And a great cry rose up, "We be all dead men." And Pharaoh rose up in the night and called from his throne, "Get ye forth from among my people. Go, serve God. Gone." And Moses, "We will. Thou young, with our old, with our sons and with our daughters, with our flocks and with our herds will we go. We have seen this day that God liveth." The children of Israel did go up out of Egypt in mixed multitude, on foot with their flocks and herds, and said to the people, "Hear, O Israel, remember this day when the strong hand loaned you out of bondage." The Lord went before them, a pillar of cloud to lead the way, by night a pillar of fire. So came at last through the desert to the Red Sea, camped there. But then Pharaoh was told where they fled. His heart was turned again. He said, "Why have we thus to let Israel go?" So he chariot, and all the chariots of Egypt, captains over every one, pursued the children of Israel, encamped by the sea. Now when they beheld Pharaoh's host draw near, they were afraid, and cried out to Moses, "Were there no bread in Egypt? Thou taken us away, die in wilderness." But Moses said, "Hold your peace, the Lord will fight you." Moses stretched out his hand to the sea, and waters were divided. Sea, dry land. Children of Israel went in the midst. Waters were a wall on the right, left. He had pursued all Pharaoh's host after them through the sea. Then Moses said, "Fear not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord." Again he stretched forth his hand, and the waters returned over all the host. All died, none remained. And Moses cried, "Who is like unto thee, O Lord? Didst blow with the wind, and the sea covered them. Who shall live? And now do this,
Thou hast borne us out of Egypt. An eagle bears his young upon his wing. Thou hast borne us out of Egypt, bears his young upon his wings. This is clarion shout of triumph and thanksgiving is one of the most glorious signs in the Bible. It marks the fulfillment of God's deliver the children of Israel in their generation, bitter bodies in fair brick pit. It just the wisdom of God's judgment in plucking a slow-spoken shepherd from the slopes of Sinai. So is his mighty hand as awesome taking.
I met a traveler from an antique land who said two vast and legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them in the sand, the shadow lies, whose own and wrinkled lip and sear of cold command tell that sculpt well those passion red jets of. On the pedestal, the words appear. My name is Amandius, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Boundless of air. The lone and little sands stretch far away.
The subject of Shelley's famous poem was the shattered visage of the great pharaoh Ramses, whose throne name, Osirmare, became Ozymandias over the centuries and fueled the great poet's imagination. Though acting as the hand god, Moses might himself have seen be the eagle that bore the Israelites out of Egypt. He'd stood steadfast against the wrath of Pharaoh, calmed the people through the plagues God reigned Egypt, and sustained their spirit through that full night of the Passover. He'd led the children of Israel out of bondage through the Red Sea, destroying Pharaoh's chariot army. Now Pharaoh was dead, and the Israelites were free. Only wilderness lay ahead of them.
So Moses brought Israel through the wilderness. They went many days and found no water. The people were afraid, but Moses said to them, "Ye murmur in your tents. You have seen how the Lord sustains you as and doth carry his son in all the ways that go. He knoweth by walking through this great wilderness, ye lack nothing. The Lord brings you unto good land, a land of brooks, water, fountains and depths that spring out of valleys and hills. That land drinketh of the rain of heaven. He will give you water in due season, first rain and the last. He humbles you and serves you to thirst, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread only. The Lord did not choose you because you were more number than people, for you were the fewest. But because the Lord loved you, he redeemed you from the hand of Pharaoh. He lead you through a wilderness of scorpions and drought where there is no water. Who can bring forth water out of flint? So beware lest you forget him who brought you forth out of Egypt." But still the people wept all that night, crying, "What shall we drink? Would God we had died in Egypt, for the Lord brought us in this land to perish here. Let us make a captain and return into Egypt." And Moses said, "Hear now, ye rebels. Must we fetch you water out of the rock?" And he lifted his hand and with his staff struck the rock twice. The water came out, sweet, abundant, and people drank and camped there by the waters. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "I have heard the murmuring of Israel. I will rain food from the heavens for you. Speak them and say so." And in the morning it was so. On the ground lay food like the frost. Moses said, "This is the bread the Lord hath given you. It is manna. Take it and eat." And they did so. They took food of the Lord, and the taste of it were like honey. So the multitude went on, many thousands of Israel, journeying to the land which the Lord had promised, days of gladness and solemn days. And the glory of the Lord with them through all journeys. But at last they peeped again, and shouted, saying, "Who shall give us meat to eat? We did eat in Egypt freely, fish, cucumbers, and melons, but now there is nothing but this manna." And Moses heard them and said to the Lord, "What shall I do with these people? Have I conceived them? They be already to stone me." thy father, thou should say to me, carry them in thy bosom. They weep me, saying, this meat, where shall I have meat for all? Shall the flocks and the herds be slain for them, or all the sea? I am not able to do all this. It's too heavy for me. But the Lord said to Moses, the Lord and was short. See now, am I will come to pass or not. Moses went out and told the people, the Lord will give you meat, and ye shall eat. Not one day or 10, but a month until it come to your nostrils, because ye wept before him, saying, why came we out of Egypt? But Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses. They said, hath the Lord indeed spoken only to Moses? The young man ran and told Moses, and Joshua said, my Lord Moses, from them. But Moses said, dost thou envy me? Would God that all the people were prophets, so the Lord would put his spirit upon them. And Moses and the elders went into the camp. But there came forth a wind now, and the Lord spoke suddenly to Moses and Aaron and Miriam. Hear now my words. If there were a prophet among you, I would make myself known to him. My servant is Moses. To him will he speak. Then Moses said to them, oh, ye voice of God, I stand between God and you, lest ye be afraid. God, a man, did he lie? Hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? As he loved fathers, he brought you out of Egypt. Therefore, rise up, Israel. We have stayed long enough in this place. Turn and take journey to the great river. Strong is dwelling place. Ye have seen your nest, rock. Only take heed, lest forget God. After 3 months, they came at last to the wilderness of Sinai and camped there before the mountain. And it came to pass in the morning, the thunder and a thick cloud amount in the voice of a trumpet. And people trembled and the mountain quaked. But Moses said, fear not, God is come to prove you. He climbed up into the darkness where God is. Stayed many days and many nights, cloud covered. Glory of the Lord. But when he came down, the people gathered for Aaron, said to him, Aaron, you shall make us gods to go before us. As for Moses, know not what become. So unto them, break off the golden rings, the ears of your wives and your daughters. Bring them to me. And the people did so. They stripped off their ornaments, all the spoils of Egypt, brought them to Aaron. And he rolled and fashioned a golden calf and said, this be thy God, O Israel. Yet, afar off in the mountain, Moses drew near where God was and heard him. Now, Moses, I teach you that they may live. I declare unto you my 10 commandments. Let them dip from thy, all the days of thy life. Teach them. Then the words the Lord spoke with a great voice. I, Lord God, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day. Keep it holy. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days be long in the land. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not covet anything that is thy neighbor's. And the Lord spoke with Moses as a man speaks to his friend. When he'd made an end, he gave him 2 tablets of stone, written with the finger of God. And the writing was the word of God. Throughout the last 4 books of Moses, God gives him very specific and detailed instruction on matters. Chapter on the construction of the Ark of the Covenant,
details of work and sacrifice, pages of specific tribal law and punishment, all of which Moses commits to memory. It's interesting to note that throughout the entirety of both Testaments of the Bible, God only writes down his instructions once, when he delivers his Ten Commandments to Moses. Having declared his commandments with a great voice, God gives Moses two stone tablets written with the finger of God. The phrase written in stone has since become a common idiom for permanence. You're not likely to change something carved in stone, especially in God's hand. That seems to be what God has in mind. Moses is to make these commandments preeminent over God's other pronouncements. Interwoven with Christ's 11th commandment that you love one another, commandments are a common foundation for the ethical philosophy of Western civilization. This stone may have been worn down a little over the centuries, but the covenant remains. Again, we see across the centuries the power of the written word. The New Testament will tell us later, in the beginning was the word. Moses is also a tragic figure of classic dimension. A tragic hero, by definition, is a great man brought down by a fatal flaw in his own nature. After his triumph in delivering the Israelites from bondage at God's command and direction, Moses led them through the years of wandering in the wilderness of sin. For Moses, this must have been an internal odyssey as well. He was struggling under the stress of a burden of command unmatched in history. He had to hold the confidence of a fractious people, keeping their spirits high through the privation of the desert, yet above all, always responding to the precise instructions of Lord God. Somewhere in those desperate years, his iron will, his own self-doubt, or perhaps his pride, hubris, the fatal failing of men, brought him into conflict with God. He delivered the law and children of Israel to the very banks of the Jordan, within sight of his goal. But he was only to look across the river at a promised land that God would deny him. Moses remains one of the last and greatest voices of God until Christ. And the Lord spoke with Moses, a man speaks to his friend. And when he'd made an end, he gave him two tablets of stone, written with the finger of God, and the ring was the word of God. So Moses turned and went from the mountain, and his face shone. He came to where Joshua was, said, "There is a noise of war in camp." But Moses heard the voice of God, who said, "Go get thee down, for thy people have corrupted themselves." They came to the camp, where the people drank and played naked before the golden calf. And his sword in his anger waxed hot. He put, "Hath the Lord brought you out and first to be him as you are this day? I call an earthness, how ye have set before now life, death, and evil. He that is on the Lord's side, come to me." Moses cast the tablet from his hands, and beneath the golden calf, and the people peered. The wicked fell on their faces. But then fire went out from the Lord. Earth opened, swallowed all. They went alive, and the pit oozed upon them. They died before the Lord. Till at last, Moses stood between the dead and the living, saying, "Now pardon the people, I beseech thee in thy mercy. Hold off thy fierce wrath, O Lord, or blot me from thy book." And the plague was dead. But the Lord's anger was killed against Israel. He wandered in the wilderness 40 years, till all the generation that had done evil was consumed. But at last, there came a morning in the plains of Moab when the Lord spoke to Moses. "Rise, Moses, rise. Get thee up this mountain, and behold the land which I give Israel. Thou shalt see that before thee, but thou must go there. Thou shalt be unto me. I will give thee rest." And he said, "The congregation of the Lord have no shame, that before them a man who can." And the Lord said, "Take Joshua, some of thine honor of him, who will put thy name upon the children." Moses went towards the camp. He was old. His eye was not dim.
goodly are thy tents, O Israel. Then he called his two, saying, Hear, O Israel, thou art to pass over Jordan this day. I have led you 40 years in the wilderness, where ye did noonday as the bind rope in darkness. Ye been a rebellious people from the day that I knew you. Yet ye are my people. Behold, ye are this day as the stars of heaven are multitude. May the Lord make ye 1,000 times any more than you are. May he bless you and keep you, and none make you aid. Then was called Joshua. He laid hands on him and said, Be strong, good courage, for thou must lead this people into the new land. The Lord was angry with me for your sake. He said that I may not go, O Jordan, I in this land. You shall go all and possess that good land. And when the Lord shall have brought thee to that land, he swore to thy fathers, a land of wheat and honey, where ye shall lack nothing, with houses full of good things which ye built, vine tree plant. When ye shall in and are full, then keep thou these words in thy heart. Not the people forget, but your own. Love ye therefore stranger. For ye were strange in Egypt, when harvest field and this sheaf. Do not again get it. Let it be the strange fatherless. So you shall remember that ye were slaves in it. Your brethren the stranger, judge righteously, for all men are brothers. Be not afraid. If ye turn aside from God, then the anger of the Lord shall smoke against you. But if ye seek the Lord, find him. If ye seek with all your heart and all your soul, the Lord is a merciful God. When ye are in tribulation, if ye turn to the Lord, he will forsake you. And as truly as I live, all earth shall fill with the glory of the Lord. Now go. Proclaim liberty throughout the lands unto all inhabitants thereof. Thus Moses blessed Israel and hearkened unto him. Then Joshua led the whole for Jordan. And this went up into Nebo. The Lord showed him all the promised land from Judea unto the utmost sea. Then God said to him, This is thy. So Moses died there. No one knows his sepulcher, even this day. There are not a prophet since, unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Behold, his mighty so God last his people to that good land he promised first to them. It described as core Jewish experience, as a people, a nation, and a faith. It was promised with Moses the instrument of his will. Revered the religions, good to none. This flawed and angry man showed God and the world the capacity of the human spirit. And there arose not a prophet since in Israel like a Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face.